Great. And we are live. I want to thank everyone for tuning in to a very special edition of Off the Record on the People's Podcast this afternoon. We have an incredible guest with us, one who's going to give us some amazing information as well as inspiration, and that is none other than the legendary Sis Tadarah Muhammad herself. Assalamu alaikum, ma'am.
Wa alaikum salam.
We are very excited to have you. On behalf of myself, my family, and the viewing audience, again, this is part two, because the first interview went so well, we had to bring you back for part two. Savior's Day, first of all, even though it's already passed, I still feel the Savior's Day spirit, so happy Savior's Day, Sis Tadarah.
Happy Savior's Day.
Yes, ma'am. What a wonderful weekend that we just had. We're going to go, the drill competition, of course, is something that we are very passionate about, but I just wanted to ask you, the overall weekend, how was your experience?
Well, I work most of the time, so I enjoy doing that. That is the gist of my Savior's Day. I had a good time because I love what I do. We had our MGT class, and that was fun. And then I went to the youth social. I was there, and that was amazing. And then the drill competition, I served as a judge this year for the very first time.
Yes, ma'am. And,
the Savior's Day lecture on Sunday. So everything was amazing. It was the great Savior's Day.
All praise is due to Allah. Yes, ma'am. And to all of the young people, but specifically the young sisters who see you, and they've seen you, of course, in drill competitions, but seen you soldier in the nation for all of these years, protecting the believers, but of course the Honorable Minister was Farrakhan and his wife, Mother Farrakhan. What advice would you give to those young sisters who want to, help serve and soldier in the nation?
Wow. So the thing is this, I had to work my way up there. When I joined the nation, I started out as working in the checkpost area. I held every post. I worked hard. I went to my classes, excelled in my class, one of the best and top in the Vanguard class, moved up. I did hostess post, front row post. I secured front rostrum with Sister Ava. May Allah be pleased with her, Mother Tynetta. I did personal security on our national MGT captain, Sister Emeritus Bessie Jean Farrakhan. So basically, that job is not for everybody, because everybody may not feel that that's what they want to do. Because when we do that, we put our life on the line. And I heard the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan say once that when we secure him and secure his family or our principals, we may not make it home that night. So we have to be willing to put our life on the line and die for that which we say that we believe in. So that is the advice that I would give a young sister coming in the nation who has that burning desire in her heart to want to do that, because that's where it comes from. It comes from your heart.
All praise be to Allah. Beautiful. Okay, now, Sis Tadarah, being all the principles that you named, and just the climate of the 80s, the 90s, 2000s, all the way up to now, do you ever face fear? Are you ever nervous when you're like you said, you may not make it home? Do you get nervous, and if so, how do you overcome that nervous?
Well, I cannot remember ever being nervous. I was just like, I don't know, I was excited. My mind shift changes. I just really turn into a different person. So it's like my mindset is just on basically what I'm doing. So I can't say that I ever felt fearful, because I didn't. I'm saying. And I think that it was basically from my heart, which I didn't know it was there until I was actually going through the training. All I know is that when I first went to the mosque and I saw the Vanguard, And I knew that they were different because, you know, you feel their spirit, you see how they walk, you see their demeanor. And I remember looking at them saying, you know what, who are they? And a sister that was sitting next to me, she said, well, I don't know, they might be special security or something, because that's how they looked. Mm-hmm. And you know what, that's what I want to be. Whatever it is, whoever they are, that's what I want to do. And so I never felt fearful. I was just excited about being able to do that. And I just love it. And that's why I'm still here today doing it, because I tried to sit down. People won't let me. Allah won't let me. I won't let myself, okay? So that's when you know that you were meant to do this.
Yes, ma'am.
You know, you were meant to do something when you just cannot sit still, you just can't sit still. You just have to do it. I just got to be there. Nothing can stop me. I will be pregnant right after I had my children. I was right back. I couldn't wait to get back. So, you know, I just love what I do. That's all I could say.
Praise you to Allah. Yes, ma'am. And of course, both my sisters, Miriam and Naima, both say Assalamu alaikum, family. And thank you, everyone who's showing love all across the country. Now, Sister Dara, like you said, as soon as you had your children, you right back in it. Now, I see your children in the same mission and work as that you're in, and soldiering, whether they're drilling, holding poles, wherever they are, they're still doing this. What advice right. do you give to parents in general, but specifically mothers, on keeping their children? Like, how are you able to keep your children on, like, you know, to get your child to come to safety day, and when they little is one thing, but these, you got grown children and grandchildren, and now they at Savior's Day and in the same mission as you. What advice would you give to, you know, help other parents do the same?
Well, I would say just instill the love of Allah in them. You know, just don't be a Muslim at the mosque, but be a Muslim at home. Mm-hmm. That's just how, you know, we ran our household. We were just talking about that. They was just telling me how disciplined I was and the things I would say to them before we went into a store, you know. So, and I remember my son Tata asked me one time, he said, Mom, why you never really pushed us to go to college? And I said to him, I said, because the only thing that I ever desired for my children were for you to know who Allah is and who you are. And I figured that if I taught them that, then Allah would guide them where they want to be or where they want to go. Mm-hmm. I didn't force them to come to the mosque. I didn't say, you better do this. No, it was like, whatever. I gave them what I'm supposed to give them, and they made the decision to join.
Oh, praise you to Allah. Yes, ma'am. And on behalf of myself, my family, and the viewing audience of the People's Podcast, we want to thank Allah for you and your sacrifice and the many sacrifices of your family as well. Thank y'all for still holding it down. I wish I could have saw everybody at Savior's Day, but I got to see you and Sister Sadiqa. So to everybody else, we love y'all and thank y'all for holding it down for all of these years.
Praise Allah. We love you too.
Yes, ma'am. My next question for you is dealing. Okay, Naima said beautiful teacher. Okay, my next question for you is the drill competition. Mm-hmm. It, you know, it's the second most important, biggest event of the Savior's Day weekend. And for years, literally for years, growing up in at your drill practice when you were pregnant with your children and seeing you drill for all of these years on the stage, now you're a judge. How was the transition? How did that feel to transition from drilling to being a judge?
Wow. That's all I can say. Wow. You know, drilling, and I would be the one of the ones. The judges cheated. They cheated. They don't know what they're doing. Who they got up there? You know, I was one of those. I ain't gonna lie. Yes, ma'am. But it was, and I always wanted to do it. I just didn't know at what point in time in my life it would come. I didn't know it would ever come. But I just received a call from Sister New Saber, and she asked me would I I'd like to be on a judge. And I said, oh, please, yes, ma'am. All praises due to Allah. Now, sitting on the other side as a judge and watching the drill competition, I see what the judges go through.
Mm.
And I see how difficult it can be to make a decision, because it's like you see a team, oh my God, they were good. And then the next person coming, oh my God, they was good. So it's like, oh my God, what am I going to do? So I said, oh my God, Allah, please forgive me for saying that these people cheated. Because it was very hard. It was very hard to make a decision. And you never know what the next person put down on their paper or how they're judging or their perception. So we don't know. What I've learned is that we don't know who won. We know when everybody else knows.
Mm.
All we do is put our score down. We pass it down. We never say, well, what you think? Or I never seen nobody do that. I haven't seen anybody say, oh, you know, make an impression or that they really like that team or anything like that. So I was like, wow. But one team almost made me lose it.
Mm.
And that was FOI, LAFOI. Oh my God, I do not want to be a judge right now. Because I want to get up and scream and shout.
Yes, ma'am.
That team that made me feel like that.
Beautiful. All praises to Allah. Okay. And people are showing you love all across the country. And my sister Miriam says you are more than qualified and deserve to be a judge for the drill competition. Absolutely. Okay. So now you're sitting in the audience of the drill competition, and the DIs are naturally going to study the DIs and everything else going to work around there. What are you looking for? Because I know some DIs who around the country looking like, what are you specifically looking for from the drill instructor?
Well, how they actually command the team, how they control the mic, their discipline, their precision, all of that, you know, their creativity, their voice, how they sound, and things like that.
Okay, yes, ma'am. Perfect. Mimi said, okay, she's talking about she's talking about LA, she loved their routine and the spirit. Praise be to Allah. Perfect. All right, great. My next question for you is, when the teams come out, is there anything that they should know that can help them better get perfect scores other than what they already know from now that you're a judge?
Yes, absolutely. Now, first thing is their uniform,
okay,
their weight, and for MGT, especially, you know, we like to wear jewelry. So I would, no necklaces, because it takes away from the militancy, and we just want to keep it simple. We're not going to dinner. We're not going to a ball. So you want to just keep it strictly military and just look militant at that time. And just we take off points for the overweight sisters or brothers. And so we have to be careful of that. And it's just those type of things are kind of hard. And although they may be good drillers and things like that, and the routine may be nice, but you know, you just shave off a few points for that. And some people may be willing to risk that, like LA MGT, they had a sister who was overweight, but they still won third place. You see what I'm saying?
Yes, ma'am.
Because of their routine, because of their precision and things like that. So when we shave points, you don't shave a lot of points because it's really not that extreme. But to get a perfect score, you have to look at things like that.
Okay, great. Yes, ma'am. Now I have a question. The sisters seem to all kind of different color uniforms. That's just the normal. If the FOI or Andrew Junior FOI had any colors outside of blue and brown or something, would that help the chances, or would that be like, that's stick to blue and brown
in the junior category?
Yes, ma'am. Or FOI, like it seemed like the brothers only wear like two colors, and that just seemed to be the thing: black suit, red bow ties, or blue and brown, would like the colors help, or would that, you know what I'm saying, like?
Well, see, we have to wear a regulation garment.
Okay.
So when it comes to like FOI and the colors that they have, then that would have to just come from there's, you know, captain or supreme captain or things like that. Mm-hmm. So as long as they're in a regulation color, which is the brown, the blue, or you wear a suit or something like that.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. We gotta figure out, some of these brothers gotta get tan, white, something. We gotta get something. Cause I'm just like, the sisters are like, oh, they wore orange, they wore blue. The brothers, they all have blue. They all have, I'm like, we gotta get a third color. I'm gonna root for a third color, man.
Well, so, you know, I think they're working on it. I think we were.
Yes, ma'am. Okay. Now, because you know the cadence and you watch the drill competition like everybody else, is it when teams reuse cadences, is that like paying homage, or is that a lack of creativity, or should people recycle moves and cadences to keep it going for all these years?
Well, it all depends. Like I'm going to say like what Newark did. They were paying homage to 97.
Yes, so
I thought that was pretty cool. You know,
yes,
you
ma'am.
Had there. You had to be there. But if you have a cadence that you did last year and now you're doing it again this year, that shows a lack of creativity. It's just get points taken off for that. So, you know, you just have to be more creative. You have to study. You have to study other teams. You have to, you know, start fasting and meditating, doing something. Or it could come to you.
Yes, ma'am. Okay, so I was going to ask you. So if you saw a drill team that said half a mile by half a mile, all aboard the mothership, something like that, is that creative? Or is that like, are they paying homage to you? Or I mean, how do you feel about that?
Well, it all depends if you just copy it and don't give the credit.
Okay. Yes, ma'am.
Add it from. Then that's the difference. But if they say it, I mean, you know, they just use it, whatever. Because I remember we did Grand Rapids when a brother came out with, I think he said the FOI make earthquake or something.
Yes, ma'am.
God came back and said, well, we make thunder. So I said, okay, we're going to make God. So the MDT made God. But I didn't say the same. I just said, I said the FOI makes earthquake, the FR makes thunder, and the MGT makes, see, did nobody say that? You see what I'm saying?
Yes, ma'am.
I said where I got it from. The FOI said, so you got to just be creative with it. And you expound on things that you like. Now, if people were smart, I would study LA FOI team but I wouldn't copy what they did. You kind of build on something that you like or that you saw, but I don't like all that copying stuff. Just like when we did the forward lean, you know, New Saber came out with the backwards lean. Okay, do the forward lean. You see what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
But a lot of other people tried to do that. And that's fine, but it's okay. But it's like, do your own stuff.
Yes, ma'am.
Be creative. That's how you get it. Be creative. Do something that, you know, you ain't seen nobody do. Or I mean, ain't nothing new up under the sun, but we can expound on something that we've seen already.
Perfect. Praise be to Allah. My sister Naima says, yes, ma'am. And my sister Miriam says, yes, they have to pay homage. Okay. Now I was going to say, there seems to be a trend. A lot of people was asking about the drill instructors doing like monologues in the routine, where it's like they stop and then they start teaching and then they go back to drilling. Is that something that as a judge you all want, or do you not want that? Like help, because it's people right now practicing for next year. Should they be putting monologues in the routine, or do y'all want to see them do basics? Or what are you looking for?
That's fine, because that's not against the rule.
Okay.
It's not say, you know, they can't do that or recite general orders. I mean, that's just part of their routine.
Perfect. Yeah. All right. So I hope all the drill instructors are paying attention, especially when we put this on YouTube and the people on the team in general. Now, when you're looking, if you're looking to pick a drill instructor, so they're the FOI, junior FOI going into the FOI, the young sisters are going into the Vanguard are going to the MGC, and you have 20 people in front of you, how would you choose who the drill instructor is?
That's difficult because you have people, especially when you're from a big city, because you may have a lot of people who are very creative, who may know how to call the cadence and who's good at it. So it's kind of with who wants it the most, you know, who's hungry, who want it, you know, like me. They didn't pick me for the DI. They did not pick me. I wanted it. You see what I'm saying? I just felt something. And so a closed mouth don't get fed. So I went to who I was supposed to go to and was like, look, I want to be the DI.
Yes, ma'am.
Like, well, I didn't know that. So it may not be necessarily be that, you know, somebody, you've been overlooked. They just probably didn't think that, you know, you didn't want to do that. And I remember back in the day with the junior MG team from Chicago, they had tons of DIs that was so creative, you know. And a brother would say, he would say, sister, to her, why they won't pick my daughter to be the DI? And I said, well, you know, they just have to wait their time. Mm-hmm. I said, and she's good. She's cold. And I said, and guess what? When her time comes, she gonna win first place. So enough, it was Asia. Remember Asia, brother, yes, Abby's daughter?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
What the cadence for them juniors. I forgot what year it was. Baby, I tell you. And it was just so happened. I was sitting behind him. And when they won, announcing, he turned around. I said, I told you.
Praise be to Allah.
I told you. So, you know, you just have to, sometimes you just get, it may not be your time. And if you want it really bad, I mean, just say something. Just go to whoever it is you need to go to and say, look, I really have a desire to do this. And you know, I want to give it a try. I want to be the DI.
Yes, ma'am. Okay, I'm glad you said that. Speaking of time, how do you know if it's when it's past your time? Like when you should let somebody else get a chance to be the drill instructor?
Well, that comes with knowledge and wisdom. So when, that's why when I was in Grand Rapids, I really didn't want to do it, but we did it. I did that for them. And so that's why I brought Sadiq on. I was like, look, I think I'm going to pass the torch. You need to do this. So and that's how that happened. You just have to know. You'll know when is your time.
Perfect. Okay. Yes, ma'am. Okay, one more question about the drill instructors, because a lot of people had questions. Multiple drill instructors, does that add when they switch in the microphones? Do the judges, are y'all looking for that? Or is one... is it better with one, like from what you're saying?
Hey, it all depends. Sometimes one is just enough. One is just enough. It's okay when it's two, but three, that's just a bit too much, in my opinion. I just think two DIs, okay, you could get away with that because you could tag team. I see that creativity. You can really do something with that. But if especially when both of them are good. But when you have a DI who can just hold it on their own, that's strong like that, and then you bring somebody else on, no. That is not on your level as a DI, I don't think that's a good idea.
Okay, boom, perfectly. Okay, then my sister Miriam says we are in tune because she just asked about what do you think about multiple DIs? Is that a permanent fixture in a competition? Or do you think, okay, exactly. And you see, okay, listen, we in tune, we locked in, because a lot of people were talking about that at the same day about the multiple DIs, and then boom. All right. Perfect. Second. And thank you all for who continue to watch, like, share, and subscribe. We have a quick 60-second commercial, Sadarah, and we come right back. Please put the questions in the comments, and we can't wait to put this on YouTube so people can continue to show love all across the country. 1 second, we're coming right back. This is Sadarah. And boom.
Television and film editing. Please reach out to him if you need any of those services. Sister Miriam's, ABC I Love Me, children's book and coloring book, and now Spanish book. All three available on Amazon.com. Sister Naima's Stay on Point Dance Academy, LLC. She teaches ballet virtually to young girls all across the country, right here in the studios of Atlanta, Georgia. Dr. Henry Carter's King Henry Turkey Legs, right here in Atlanta, Georgia. Brother Rashad Muhammad's COVID-19 Disinfected Cleaning Services, out of Chicago. Student Minister Sharif Muhammad's book, A Soldier in the Movement of Christ, available on adulsharif.com. And lastly, Brother Joshua Muhammad's book, Cleopatra, as well as No Father, No Excuse, both available on Amazon.
Perfect. All right, right back to Sister Dara. Speaking of books, will you ever write a book on your journey in the nation and soldiering and security, executive protection, being a chef? Would you ever write a book on that?
You know, I've been thinking about it. I will one day soon. It was brought yesterday, as a matter of fact. It's funny you said that. But yeah, it's been on my mind for a while.
All praise is due to Allah. Yes, ma'am. Now, the next question that we have for you is your favorite Savior's Day moment being a drill instructor. What's your favorite moment?
Say that again.
Your favorite Savior's Day moment being a DI. Like your favorite Savior's Day.
The favorite one? Oh, I would really have to say 97. It was between 96, 97. I don't know. I just had a lot of good ones, Joshua. I don't know.
Okay, let's stay with 97. Why was 97 so important and so special to you?
Well, you know, because that drill team, that was a very special drill team, drill squad. It was very spiritual. I mean, we had a lot of, our mass was just going with that, you know, with that routine. So that was almost like, that was my favorite routine.
Okay.
That was my favorite.
Yes, ma'am. All right. Now, did you ever have to cut sisters in the drill team? And if you did, how did you go about that so people can know if somebody can't make the team, what's the process?
Absolutely. Because, you know, we, especially in Chicago, we had time, you know, back then we had time to practice. We had time for people to try out for the drill team, the drill squad. So yes, and they had a certain amount of time. And I don't know, I think it was like 4 weeks or something like that. And if they did not own up to the, you know, the qualifications, they were just cut. And it was like, we would just read off names who made it. And if your name was called, you made it. If your name was not, you didn't make it. Just like
okay, ma'am. All right, perfect. Sisters, some people made it, some people didn't make it. Got it? Yes, ma'am. All right, my next question is your favorite memory. We want to have this, you know, for historical reasons. Your favorite memory doing executive protection, doing security.
My favorite one?
Yes, ma'am.
I'm gonna have to say the first time that I did honor God for the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. That was in I think it was 1990, somewhere around there. Yeah, that was my favorite one because it was the first one. And that was the time when we trained for that for 3 months, all summer long, because it was an October Savior's Day. And those who made, that was the time when we had to actually literally fight to show that we were qualified to hold that position. And then, so the day of, you know, before we went on stage, the minister wanted to see us. So we went into his holding room, and I'll never forget it. He had on these dark shades, and he was just looking and staring at us. And like he was studying us. And so he said, he asked a question, and let me get it right, you know, long time ago. But he asked a question. He said, how many of you are willing to give your lives for this? And before he even got finished the sentence, I raised my hand. That's all I remember doing, raising my hand. And he looked, he was sitting there like this. And he looked, we couldn't see his eyes. And he nodded his head. And he said, they ready. And it was like all over. We went, he and I walked out. We walked out behind him. And we was ready. You know, electrifying. You can feel his energy. It was very strong. It was very powerful. And it made me feel powerful and strong. And it was just amazing. And it was just like a wow moment. I really can't explain it, but it was different. And I was willing to die that day if I had to.
Beautiful. Okay, yes, ma'am. Now, we often talk, well, we spoke earlier about you and the advice that you've given because of your children, your mothering, and Allah blessing your womb. But what about your parents? Could you let us know who your parents are so we can have that for historical reasons as well? For people who didn't get the chance to see him at the salam all the time and always being kind and nice, could you let us know who your parents are?
Okay, so my mom is Sister Dora Muhammad, and my father is Brother Charles Muhammad. And my father is the one who brought Islam to our home when I was in high school. Mm. And wasn't trying to listen to him at that time, but it was him. And I remember Tanisha was 5 years old and getting ready to go to kindergarten. I don't know if I told this story before, but Muhammad University, it was in 1989, and Muhammad University was just opening that year for this fall season. So he came to me and said, Dana, you know, would you let Tanisha go to Muhammad University of Islam? You know, I'll pay the tuition. And I was like, no, she's not going to that school. She's going to Beasley. That was like a good academic school back in Chicago at the time. So, and I just walked away. I walked out the living room, and I was in a room. I remember being in a room talking to my sister, and I was just telling her what Dad had just said. And I was like, she ain't going to that school. In the middle of the conversation, a voice said to me, get up and tell your father that Tanisha can go to that school. I didn't hear my sister talking anymore. I heard that voice as clear as I'm talking to you. And all of a sudden, I just got up. I just followed, like I was being led or guided to do that. And I was there. My father was sitting on the sofa. And I said, Dad, I'm going to let her go. He hopped up so fast. He was like, okay, let's go. But years later, he told me that he was sitting in there praying that I would change my mind. And that is how quickly Allah intervened in that affair. Word is bond to Allah. And it was Tanisha going to Muhammad University of Islam, being taught Islam, coming home saying, yes, ma'am, no, ma'am, and drilling. Tanisha was drilling before I was drilling. You know, and she was just a different child. And I remember going to pick her up one day from school, and it was Brother Shahid and Brother Brian. They were at the gym door. And I said, I'm coming to pick up Tanisha. And they said, you Tanisha's mom? I said, yes. And he said, she a soldier. I said, a soldier? I'm like, what do you mean? And he was like, she come in popping those salutes and clicking her heels. And she was just 5 years old in kindergarten. And I said, yeah, she does that stuff at home. Had no clue as to what they were doing up there, what they were teaching. I didn't know none of the teachings, but it was being inspired by my daughter that led me to the mosque to go.
See, we learned.
But yeah, my dad, I'm sorry, I got off track, but my dad, it was because of him too. And he worked, and then after I joined, my parents joined after they saw me do honor guard for the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan in 1990. Mm. There, and they was at the Savior's Day and they were crying when they saw me up there. And that's when they joined. And my father started, you know, doing security. He went, your father sent him to DC to train. And he came back and he became, when the salon was open, he became like the chief security over at the salon. And yeah, that was my dad, Brother Charles.
All praise. I didn't know that. Yeah. I just knew he was serious with deep voice. I was like, all right, hey, all right, baby. I never knew about the training and all of that. Okay, beautiful. My sister Miriam says that's powerful. The power of prayer is real. Excellent. Yeah. We can't wait to put this on YouTube. Man, that's powerful. Okay, Sister Tadarah, excellent question. Boom. All right. Thank you very much. Well, I want to thank you for taking time out of your busy schedule, Sister Tadarah, to come on the People's Podcast to give us some amazing information as well as inspiration and give us some insight to the mind of the judges. So that all of the teams can be more patient with you all, because she, you know.
Exactly. Exactly.
Yes, ma'am. Well, I want to thank you again. Thank your family. It's nothing but love. May Allah continue to bless you and the family. Inshallah, we'll see you in person sometime soon in the future, so that we can finish picking your brain and hear some amazing history and great stories. Please give your family the greetings. Thank everyone for watching. This is Dr. Leonard Muhammad signing off of the People's Podcast. Assalamu alaikum, ma'am.
Wa alaikum salam.
Thank you very much. Boom.